So the topic is timing issues in digital circuits. So we start from the consideration that in all digital circuits, in all sequential circuits, events must be ordered. Correctly. This is necessary in order to, this is needed to ensure proper operation of the circuits. And the most common approach to order all events is to use synchronization. So the so-called synchronous approach. It's not the only one, but is for sure the most commonly adopted. What does it mean? It means that all memory elements are updated at the same time. And this is possible by using the clock signal. So, what is the clock? It's a periodic synchronization signal. Of course, this statement is the ideal case, and what we want to discuss now is the real case, what happens in practice. Because in practice, what you have is that you do not have a clock signal which is synchronous over the whole chip, but you have two different orders of issues. You can have spatial variations of the clock. Okay, and then you can have temporal variations of the clock, which means that the clock signal is not perfectly periodic. And we are going to examine these issues. So the problems are the spatial, let me highlight them as problems. So in reality, you have spatial variations of the clock, which really means that, for example, the phase of the clock is not exactly the same in two different points of the circuits, and this, of course, can cause problems. This issue is called skew. Okay, and then we can have a temporal variation of the clock, even in the same spatial position. And this is typically called jitter. They both have to be taken into account. Of course, they can be both present in different quantities, in different situations. So on the other hand, on the other end of the spectrum, we have also the possibility of having a completely asynchronous approach. I would say that this is not in vogue anymore. Now it's used only in very particular and specific cases, but an asynchronous approach essentially means that you have no clock, or at least no global clock. You can have some local clock for some sequential circuits, but no global clock. So you have no synchronization whatsoever, but you have a negotiation. Which means that you have the so-called handshaking, some sort of so-called handshaking protocols in order to let two different parts of the circuit exchange data. Handshaking, of course, there's a good advantage in not needing a clock, because we shall look at some pictures of a complete die, and the clock distribution takes a lot of space in the circuit and a lot of power consumption during operation. So there is an advantage of not using a clock. On the other hand, negotiation is expensive from the point of view of the overhead of circuitry that you need, and often you have some loss of performance due to this negotiation before exchanging any type of data. With a clock, it's you don't need negotiation, because at any clock period you can move the data. With negotiation, of course, sometimes you need more time to move the data. Yeah, this is the other extreme, and there are some intermediate situations. Then there are some additional problems that are always present, and that typically need some consideration. When you have to synchronize circuits that belong to different clock domains. So let's write here synchronization between different clock domains. You can see the problem. You can this is not a problem that you have on a single chip. This is not the problem that you have typically also on a board, because on a board you in most cases you have a single clock that then is distributed over the whole board. But sometimes you can have different chips that need to use different clocks for several reasons, or you can have communication between different boards, and each board is synchronized with a different clock oscillator, and then synchronization can be an issue, because you do not have the same frequency. If you have the same frequency, maybe it's not exactly the same, but the phase, of course, it's completely random, and then there are huge problems with this situation. This must be tackled. Okay, let's start to delve into this issue with some classification to look into the most common problems. So, we are discussing now systems that use a global clock. Okay, we do not consider the asynchronous case for the moment, only systems that use a global clock. Also, in that case, you can have at least three different categories of signals, and therefore of associated systems. You can have the completely synchronous systems and signals. Synchronous signals. Then you can have mesochronous systems. In Italian, it would be mesocroni. Uh, and synchronous, of course, would be synchrony. And then you can have also plesio chronos systems signals. So meso is a Greek root that means middle. And plesio is a Greek root that means almost quasi. So. So let's look first at the synchronous signals. So two synchronous signals are synchronous in the sense that they are synchronized with a local clock at the same frequency and fixed phase difference. This means that, of course, the time delay between the positive edge of one signal and the other signal is fixed and typically known. Of course, this cannot be zero because there are delays in the signal propagation. The typical situation in which you have this type of signals is, for example, when you have a register, combinatorial logic, and then the register again. For example, this is the input signal, then you have a register, and then you have a signal which is called Cin. This is the clock. Then you have some combinatorial logic here, then Cout is the output of the combinatorial logic, and then you want to sample it again in a second register. Let us call R1, R1 and R2. Did you sample with the same clock, and then you have the output signal. So, of course, in this situation, Cin is synchronous with the clock. And then Cout, let's say, follows Cin after a certain set in time, which is not actually fixed, follows Cin after a set in time. I use the capital letter just to highlight the word. Typically they are all small capitals. Not capitals, normal letters. I just highlight the most important words of the phrase. The set in time is also called uncertainty time. And then after a while the signal is ready, can be sampled again. So also out is synchronous with the clock. If you look at this picture, you can also notice something that will be important when we discuss timing issues. is the fact that since you use the same clock and in the middle between these two registers you have some combinatorial logic, the setting time, the so-called uncertainty in time, actually puts an upper bound to the maximum frequency of operation, because the time period of the clock signal must be at least sufficient to, let's say, at least larger than the uncertainty period, of course. So let me just stress this part. This puts an upper bound on clock frequency, since clock frequency is proportional to performance. It's an upper bound to performance. Okay, then we have the mesochronous signal. Also here I use the capital letters just to highlight the part of the word. Of course it's not necessary. The mesochronous signal, in this case the situation is the following. You have this, the same frequency, so two signals are mesochronous if they have the same frequency but a varying phase difference. Phase is with pH, phase difference. And this is the typical case that you have when you want to connect to blocks belonging to different clock domains. So the same clock oscillator but a different clock domain can bring you to have the same frequency but a phase different which varies in time. And what's the solution that one has to follow? Of course one has to adjust the phase difference, and the thing is pretty simple. For example, you have one part of the system, let's call it block A, then you have a register here, let us call it R1, and then you have, for example, a clock signal, let's call it clock A. And then you have an interconnect line, which of course adds some delay. So let's call this data D1, this data D2. And then if you want to connect a system which is associated to a different clock, the thing that you need to do is the following. Let me use a different color in order to be more clear. Let's assume that here we have a block B and we want to receive this signal. So the situation is the following. One has to use here a variable delay line. After this which is just a delay line, but the most important part is that it is the delay is tunable. You can control the delay. Then you have D3, which is just the replica of D2 delayed. Then you can have a register here, R2, and then you can go to block B. This register is controlled as block B by a second clock. Let's call it clock B. So you see, what's the problem? The problem is that since you do not know exactly the phase of the data, you do not know exactly when to sample. And the solution here is the following. You take D3, you take the clock, and use here a specific block which does a phase detection. So this is a phase detector. It compares the phase of D3 with the phase of clock B. The comparison is pretty easy. It's enough to, let's say, start a ramp when you have the positive edge of clock D3 and then end in the ramp when you have the positive edge of clock B. Then you have a voltage. If this is a voltage ramp, then you have a voltage which is proportional to the phase difference. And then you use this quantity to control. So this is a phase detector and control. Use this quantity to control the delay. So that you ensure that D3 is properly synchronized with clock B by adjusting this variable delay line. So just to test again what we said about the definitions, what we have here is that D1 and D2 are of course synchronous with clock A. And let's call this D4. D4 by definition is synchronous with clock B. They are synchronous with clock A and mesochronous. Mesochronous with clock B. D4 is synchronous with clock B and mesochronous with clock A. And if you consider the situation closely, D3 is mesochronous with both clock A and clock B because it's continually adjusted. So if the control is perfect, it becomes synchronous with clock B. But in practice, there is some variation, so it's, let's say, by definition, is mesochronous with both. Okay, as you can see, this can work only if clock A and clock B have exactly the same frequency. So it's just a matter of adjusting the phase. Okay, then final category, we have the plesiochronous. Here they are less and less synchronous. In this case, basically they have slightly different frequency. So two signals that, for example, have the same nominal frequency, but of course have a slightly different frequency. In other words, one can call it, this case, the case of an increasing phase difference. Increasing phase difference. As you can see, it is exactly the same thing. It's just a matter of different wording. This situation can happen typically if you really have two different clock oscillators in two subsystems. They are synchronized at the same frequency, nominally, of course, but in practice you can have a small difference that, of course, you can see as a phase difference which increases in time. And therefore, it brings huge problems to synchronization in sequential systems. this is, for example, the case in which you have a transmitter and a receiver. Of course, the transmitter, radio transmitter and the radio receiver. The transmitter has its own clock, the receiver has its own clock. If they are on the same channel, probably the frequency is the same. They maybe they have a quartz oscillator exactly at the same frequency, but still there can be differences. And in this case, the typical solution is to use a FIFO. Okay, FIFO is an acronym which means first in, first out. It's just a buffer in which you put all data and then you pull out the data in the same order in which you put the data in. So what's the situation? For example, we have an originating module here, originating module. For example, this is the transmitter. Then we have clock C1, and then all the data are put into a FIFO here. Of course, the FIFO must also, let's say, communicate back. It depends. Typically, it has communicate back at least when it's full. And then we have the receiving module. I have a spelling problem. No, not like this. Maybe it's just with an I. Receiving module. And this is which is controlled by clock C2. So the receiving module reads from the FIFO, and of course it sends commands. So data go in this direction and command go in this direction. The FIFO can be controlled by clock signal C3, which is generated by a timing circuit, which has to recover the clock of the originating module. Typically, the situation is like this. From the data, the timing circuit is able to recover the clock of the originating module and to use it in order to control the FIFO. Because, of course, in a FIFO you have to sample the data. You have to sample the data which are coming from the originating module, and so you need to synchronize them. So there's the need to recover. Let me write it here. Timing circuits. Recovers the clock from data and drives. Of course, if the difference between the frequencies is more or less random, around zero, so sometimes a bit more, sometimes a bit less than zero, then the FIFO is the perfect solution, because you just need to have a large enough FIFO in order to, let's say, compensate for all the frequency differences. Because then during some time you have the FIFO that gets fuller and fuller, and then you can let's say, discharge it. On the other hand, if this phase difference is significant, then at some point the FAFO becomes full, and then it's useless. You have to, let's say, drop the data and restart again. And this is a situation which is very typical, actually. So there's an issue with the proper dimensioning of the FIFO, but then this is only possible if the frequency difference is extremely small. Okay, I would say these are special situations. I'd like now to go discussing in a bit more detail the asynchronous signal, because just to show you an example of what one can do when really one does not have a clock signal available. The thing is the following. Let's assume you have two blocks, two asynchronous blocks connected. So you have, for example, the logic block A, and then from the logic block A you want to move the data to a logic block B, so to a register, a memory, a local memory in which to store the data for the computation, and then you have a logic block B. And if you do not have a clock signal, how do you move the data? Well, typically, as I mentioned before, you need to use handshaking. What does it mean in practice? In practice, you have the following situation. So you sample the data, then you run the logic here asynchronously, so without any clock. When the computation is finished, you have a data valid signal. This goes, for example, to one. And then you have here some circuitry for the interconnections. So let's call interconnect circuitry. Interconnect circuitry. The logic is the following. When you know that, when the interconnect circuitry knows that the data is valid, does the following thing. It informs the interconnect circuitry connected to the logic block B and signals, okay, you can take the data now. Circuitry. So with this information, the interconnect circuitry can drive the register, so sample the data and run the computation in logic block B. So the information goes in this direction. Okay, then it can inform back when the computation is finished, and the interconnect circuitry can initialize again the logic block and update the input. And the thing continues in the same way. Also, logic block B issues the data valid bit when the computation is finished, and then, of course, is controlled by an initialize. And the thing goes on. So if these logic blocks are pretty large, you can have a limited number of handshaking to do. The handshaking, of course, is both here between the logic block and the interconnect circuitry, and between two interconnect circuitries. So you have lots of back and forth interactions, and so this is what I was mentioning when I was saying that you have this handshaking that introduces overhead. And performance loss. Yeah, with the wait time for the handshaking protocols. But then there is the advantage of having computation at maximum speed. In the logic blocks. Because typically in a synchronous circuit you proceed in the computation with the clock, and then the clock is not the maximum speed at which each block can go. It is the maximum, let's say, possible speed to keep everything synchronous. Another advantage that you have, you do not have to distribute the clock. No clock distribution. That is very costly and energy hungry. Okay, I'm saying it again, but really this type of operation is only used in very few cases as of now. Okay, now let's look at the non-idealities of the clock. So, skew and jitter. Before we do that, let's open a parenthesis here. Let's consider some definition of time in registers and combinatorial logic. This is something that you should already know, but it's useful to at least recollect some definitions. So let's consider a D flip-flop, a triggered, and let's look at the timing. So you have a clock signal, then you have the D signal, and then you have the V signal. So I'm putting here synchronized signals as a function of time. So we have the clock, the D, and the Q. This is the flip-flop. This is a D, this is Q, and this is the clock. So for example, we have this part, then the clock goes to zero, then it goes to one again, and during the positive edge of the clock we have the sampling of the data. What are the important issues here? The fact is that the data must change sufficiently in advance before the positive edge of the clock, and must be, let's say, kept for a sufficient time after the positive edge of the clock. Okay, we have two times that are important here. We take time from the situation in which the voltage is half VDD, half the supply voltage. So from here to here, this is called setup time, TSU. And from here to here, this is called T hold, hold time. So TSU is the setup time. And T hold is the hold time. So this is needed in the sense that if you don't keep D constant at least for T setup before the positive edge and for T hold after the edge, there's no guarantee that Q will keep the data, keep the information properly. So those are minimum times. Then what about Q? Also with Q, we have some definition of time. What happens typically is that after the positive edge, you wait some time, and then Q starts to change. It can change significantly, and then it, for example, arrives at a finite and at a definite value. So you have some time during which there are changes in the value of D of Q, and then you have the finite value. Of course, you know that you can have these random variations because there are different paths in the combinatorial logic, and it's difficult to predict which path will arrive first. And so you have to take into account this situation. So one typically uses two quantities here in order to define this situation. One is the propagation delay, which is defined as the maximum propagation delay. It's the time after which the data is constant and is taken from the positive edge of the clock. So it's here. So our assumption is to take the propagation delay and all the times when the signal is half VDD, half the one value. So this one is called T CQ, is propagation delay. CQ, it's from the clock to Q, because it's taken from the positive edge of the clock to the constant Q. And then there is also this other time, the minimum time before which things can change. So, and this is called T, in this case we can call it TCQ cond. CD. So let's call TCQ, comma CD. This is called contamination delay. What's the meaning of that? When the clock arrives and the input has changed, the output does not change at all for at least a time equal to the contamination delay. After that, it changes any time, and then after a time equal to the propagation delay, it does not change anymore. So this is the situation for the registers, and we can define similar quantities also for the combinatorial logic. we shall see why this is important, and also we shall see why this is called contamination delay, because the origin of the word is not immediate, not intuitive now, but we shall see the reason for that with an example. For the logic, the situation is probably simpler to describe. We have, let's say, the input and the output. This is time and time. Let's call this in, and this is out. It can be an array. It's not important because I will not use just 1 and 0. So I invert the colors here. For example, at this point, we change the inputs. Okay. And then what happens is that the output for some time are not changing, and then start to change sometime and up and reach another constant value if, of course, the input is kept constant. So this is the situation, and of course here there are two times which are important. Analogously to what we have already defined, we have the small one, which is called again contamination delay. The main difference is that the contamination delay in this case is measured from the input to the output. In the case of the registers, it is measured from the clock to the output. And this can be called T logic, comma CD, contamination delay. And then we can have the other time, this one, which is of course the propagation delay. It's the maximum. By definition, the propagation delay is really the worst case time, the worst case time needed in order to have a constant output. This is the propagation delay. Let's call it T logic. Okay, we need to know these numbers for each gate, because these numbers for each gate will be the ones that will determine, for example, the clock frequency at which the circuit can run. Now, let's consider the case of a synchronous circuit, when we have a register here, let's call it R1. So this is D, this is Q, and this is the clock. Then we have some combinatorial logic here. And then we have here another register. They are both controlled by the same clock. We already have the definitions for each the important times for each block. For the combinatorial logic, we have T logic and T logic contamination delay. For the register, we have T setup, T hold, and T CQ, comma CD, the contamination delay. These are the five quantities. Of course, the second register is equal to the first if it's the same type of circuit. Now, there are two things that must be considered here, two inequalities that we have to write and that have an impact on performance. Consider this situation. When the clock arrives, you have sampling of D by register R1. Then Q goes to the proper value. Then you have the combinatorial logic, then the data is ready, Then you have another clock, another positive edge of the clock, and you sample D in register 2. So what's the time you have to wait from the first positive edge of the clock and the second positive edge of the clock? You need to wait for the following thing. You have to wait for the I forgot the propagation delay of the register that I indicated before, but I just forgot. So you have to wait for the propagation delay of the register plus the propagation delay of the combinatorial logic, and then the setup time of the second register. So you have that T must be larger than T propagation delay of the register plus T logic plus T setup. Because the data here must be ready at least T setup before the new edge of the clock. Okay, so this is the first inequality that you have to keep in mind. And then there's a second one, which is a more subtle. So let's look at it in detail. Look at D as an input of R2. What is happening there? When the new, when the second positive edge of the clock arrives, and R2 is sampling D, at the same time we are updating R1, right? So when R2 is sampling D, R1 is updating Q, and in time what will happen is that Q will change, the combinatorial logic will change, and then the D at the input of R2 will change. Okay? But you need to remember that the data in front of R2, at the input of R2, must be kept constant for at least T hold. So we need that before anything starts to change, at least the time T hold passes. And this is another inequality, because when do things start to change? You have to wait at least the contamination delay of the register plus the contamination delay of the combinatorial logic. Before that time, nothing changes, and then you have to be sure that the t-hold of the register is smaller than the sum of the two contamination delays. Okay? So, the t-hold of the register must be smaller than the contamination delay of the register plus the contamination delay of the logic. And now you can see why it's called the contamination delay, because it is a problem. If the contamination delay is, for example, too small, and this inequality is not satisfied, before R2 has completed the sample, the input changes, and therefore you do not have a stable data, a valid data in R2. Okay, is that clear? Right. Now can move on. This situation is what happens in the ideal case. In the ideal case, you need to consider these issues. Of course, you have then a limitation on performance, which is the first inequality, because you have a minimum bound on the clock period. And then you have a design issue here, because you need to have a small t-hold in order to satisfy this inequality. Now let's look at what happens when we have some skew, because this inequalities change. So we have some clock skew. In practice, what does it mean? It means that in two different points of the circuit, you have two different phases of the clock. For example, again, this is a time axis. Here, and then you have something like this. This is clock one. And this is clock two. The frequency is exactly the same, but there is a phase difference. By definition, the skew is this difference. This is time, and for example, is indicated by the letter delta. This is the skew between clock two and clock one. With this definition, the skew is positive here. Of course, you can have a negative skew. In practice, you cannot assume the sign of the skew. It can be both positive and negative. The important characteristic is that, of course, you have just a spatial variation. From the temporal point of view, the skew is constant. It does not change in time. It is a constant phase shift. Sometimes you can predict it in advance during design, and you can also try to remove it or to compensate it during design. But some components of the skew are completely random and therefore really cannot be controlled in advance. One has to, let's say, design the circuit in a robust way so that even if some skew is present, the circuit continues to operate correctly. So how do the inequalities that I've showed you before change when you have some skew present? Let's assume that clock one, let's assume that clock one is for the first register and clock two is for the second register. So there is some delay here. Okay, we are assuming that here we have some delay, and therefore clock two is delayed with respect to clock one. We have some skew. This delay can actually be, for example, simply the interconnect line, because if the clock comes from the left, as in the as in my picture, basically you have for sure some delay because the interconnect adds some delay to the signal. So this is a situation which is pretty typical. So how do these inequalities change? Of course, what's the issue? Is that the time between the first positive edge of clock one and the positive edge of clock two now, at least in the picture that I've showed you before, is increased because clock one is here. The positive edge of clock two, which has to sample the data close to the output, is here. It's not just t, but it's t plus delta. Okay, so in this particular case, the inequality is easier because now you have to put t plus delta larger than the propagation delay of the register plus the propagation delay of the logic plus the setup time, t setup. So in this case, it's easier because you can have actually a smaller t, a higher clock frequency in order to satisfy the inequality, right? Easier, of course, it's easier if delta is larger than zero. If delta is smaller than zero, it's harder, and which means that you have a performance price. So this is the first inequality. As far as the second inequality is concerned, instead you have a larger problem now, because what happens is that it's not just the hold that you have to take into account, but the hold plus delta must be smaller than the sum of the two contamination delays. Let's look. In detail why. And the reason is easier, and it is because clock one, the first register, starts before the second one to update the data. So you actually have to reduce the t-hold if the contamination delay are the same as before, because of course the variation happens earlier. So this is a problem, actually. This is harder if delta is larger than zero. Of course, if delta is smaller than zero, it's an advantage, because it means that the first register starts later to update the data. For this reason, also, during design, one can choose the proper, one can make some choices. Let's make an example just to fix the idea. Of course, you can see that, okay, it's more convenient to have delta smaller than one, right? Because if you have some problems with the hold, if you have delta smaller than one, you can actually solve the problem, and you only pay a price in terms of clock frequency. So it's something reasonable. On the other hand, I mean, if delta is really larger and positive, you can actually not even be able to close in principle the inequality, because if delta is larger than the sum of the two contamination delay, then you cannot close the circuit, because you would need the t-hold negative, which is of course not achievable. Okay, and there are there are possibilities to for example be sure that the delta is negative. For example, just considering the circuit before, if the clock goes in a different direction with respect to the data, things become easier, because the data go in this direction, you can move the clock from the other direction. So you put the clock here, then you have some delay, let's call it, okay, this is some delay. You can also engineer the delay and increase the delay if you want it. And then you have another clock here. And of course, in this case, you have a negative delta, because clock R1, clock, so no, sorry. I put the arrow in the wrong place. So these are the registers, these are the place in which the arrow must go, and then this is one, and this is two. So by design, one can try to obtain at least the sign of the delay which one wants, and typically during design one can adjust the delays and try to compensate for different delays, because also during design one can try to simulate the circuit and also a good component of the skew, for example. I must also say that this is not so easy, because in practice you have lots of loops in a sequential circuit, so it's not easy to let's say distribute the clock in an opposite direction of the data, because sometimes you have the data that go in this direction, and then a feedback loop that brings the data back, and then of course with a clock distribution it cannot really follow all the loops. But but in many times this is possible, and it's usually taken into account. It's important to and it's important that it is usually done, this aspect of simulating the possibility of skews during the design of the circuit, in order to at least check if the design is robust enough to any possible skew. Okay, what is not really easy, and I want to show you an example, is to, let's say, extract the from the logic the contamination delays and the propagation delay when the logic is complicated. I would like to show you just an example. To look at just to see how we can let's say extract the propagation delays and the contamination delays of a rather simple logic circuit. Let's consider that here we have B, here we have the inverter. This is a simple exercise. Then we have a third input. And then we have D. It's not a nice combinatorial logic, but it's just for the purpose of understanding the concept. Then again, you take this data and you put together with this in another OR. And then you have the data. So this is OR 1, this is OR 2, this is AND 1, AND 2, AND 3. So we just look at the circuit, okay? And you should be able to see easily what is the fastest path, and which would give us the contamination delay, because the fastest path is the one that that can change first the output. Okay, it can start when the output start to change, then we have the contamination delay. So for simplicity, let's assume that all the gates, all the single gates, have the same propagation delay. Okay, let's say assumption, just for the purpose of doing this exercise, all logic gate, all gates have the same propagation delay. Let's call it T-gate, TG. Okay, so fastest path, which gives us the contamination delay, so it's easy to see, it's the one through the two ORs, through OR 1 and OR 2. You see that given a proper value of A, one can actually change. For example, if the output is 1 and A goes to 1, the output goes to 1 directly. So the presence of A can change very soon the output of the logic. So we have OR 1, OR 2. Of course, if the propagation delay is TG, it means that the contamination delay T logic CD is equal to 2 TG. Okay. Then, what's the maximum propagation delay, the so-called propagation delay by definition? Now we need to explore a little bit this circuit, because it's really made for the purpose of making the exercises. So it's not really an optimized circuit. The first thing that comes to mind is to look at the path which crosses the highest number of gates, and would be this one, the inverter, and one, and two, and three, the OR, and Y. If this path is the one that, of course, has the propagation delay equal to 5 TG, and it would be the last one, the longest one. Now, if we look at the circuit in more detail, we can see that this path is a false path, because it actually never is able to change the output. But in order to do that, we need to explore a little bit the operation of the circuit. So we can have a good hint by saying 5, the longest path, but in practice it's better to try to explore the operation of the circuit, because as you shall see, basically C and D have no effect on the output, are completely useless. So I would like to use some space here. Let me just try to use this space. I change the color. Let's look at this situation. Let's look at the critical path. So the path that is able to change the output. So when A is equal to 1, the critical path, I'm drawing a table. When A is equal to 1, all the other inputs are useless, because of course the output goes to 1, right? And the critical path is there, no table, I don't know what I was thinking of. It was some interference, probably I was thinking about something else and then I... So... the critical path is OR1 plus and OR2. Okay, we already discussed that. Then, when also the other situation is pretty easy. When B is equal to 0, you have the same situation, only B counts, because we follow the path of the inverter plus the two ORs. So when A is equal to 0, the other option, and B is equal to 0, of course the critical path is the inverter, then OR1, and then OR2. And this path would have a propagation delay of 3 TG with our assumption. Then the other option is when A is equal to 0 and B is equal to 1. The output is, I can also write here Y. Y in this case is 1, in this case would be 1. In this case, let's see what happens. Here it's easy, because when B is equal to 1, the input of the OR1 is 0 and 0, therefore the output is 0. Here the one input of OR2 is 0, and also the second input of OR2 is 0, because the input of N3 is 0, right? So the output is 0, and therefore what is the critical path? Is this one, the inverter, the OR1, the AND3, and the OR2. And this means that all the other, as you can see, the value of C and D is completely useless, and therefore the propagation delay is given by 4G, because this path, the longest path, has 4 gates in series. So propagation delay, slower path, gives us the propagation delay. And I can rewrite this is the inverter plus the OR1, then the AND3, and then the OR2. So we have a T-logic equal to 4 TG. And of course, this this is just to connect the definition of contamination delay and of propagation delay to an actual combinatorial logic. So before the contamination delay, y does not change. Okay. So the other aspect that we have mentioned but not discussed yet is the jitter, the clock jitter, to be more precise. So what is the situation here? Let's make an illustration. Again, this is time. Let's assume that these are the nominal positive edges of the clock, this one and this one. And then when we have jitter, we have the positive edge of the clock which anticipates, or which is anticipated or retarded with respect to the nominal edge of clock. So one can have a positive jitter which is retarded, or one can have a negative jitter which is anticipated. Of course, the frequency is the same, it's just the phase which is changing. Then one can have again a positive jitter or a negative jitter here. The jitter is by definition this quantity. Let us call it T jitter, TJ. TJ is easier to write. In the design phase, one typically has to take the maximum value of the jitter, the maximum possible value of the jitter, and to dimension the circuit and do the design in the worst possible case of the jitter. What is the worst situation that can happen if we consider the simple circuit worst? Considering the figure, considering the figure, this one? Yeah. Considering this one, what is the worst possible situation? Of course, the worst possible situation is that you have, is when you have the current clock period, which is delayed, and the next clock period, which is anticipated. That is the worst possible case from the point of view of performance, because in practice you have less time between two different sampling, between the sampling of R1 and the sampling of R2. So basically if you look at the first as the first inequality, instead of writing that inequality, you have to consider that T minus the jitter, the two jitter, the jitter on the positive edge and the jitter on the negative edge, must be larger than the sum of the three points. So you have a significant performance loss. Let us look at the picture again. Let's assume that you have this anticipated, and then the next delayed. The first delayed, and the second anticipated. So you have TJ2. This is TJ1. The time between one sampling and the following is this one, which is of course the period minus TJ 1 minus tj2. And this time must be larger than t propagation delay of the register plus the propagation delay of the logic plus the setup time. Of course, since you have to consider the maximum value, these two quantities are equal in during the design phase, because you have to consider the worst case. And of course, this translates into a higher clock period. If everything is the same, you need a higher clock period when you have jitter. Okay. On the other inequality, there is no impact. Because in the other inequality, I mean, if you have for both clock 1 and clock 2 an anticipation or a delay, you still have the same problem. I mean, the inequality has not changed. You have the same as you had before. So there's no problem as far as the hold time is concerned. Of course, there's a performance issue. So you have a performance price. Now, I'd like to just briefly showing you the case of both skew and jitter, just to understand that the combination of the two can be, let's say, worsen a bit the things. Let's assume that you have this. Let's write clock 1 and clock 2. So clock for register 1 and clock for register 2. Again, we can say, okay, for clock 1, this is the nominal position of the positive edge. For clock 2, we have, let's say, a positive skew. So the nominal position of the positive edge is the following. This difference is the skew. Then, in addition to that, you have the jitter. And so you can have some variation here. Or you can have a positive jitter in the other direction. And also for clock 2, of course, it's exactly the same thing, because it's the same clock. So you can have a negative jitter. Or you can have a positive jitter. In this case, what is the situation? So again, from the point of view of performance, you have T plus D plus TJ1 plus TJ2 larger. Then the sum of the three times. So of course also here a negative skew would at least compensate the performance loss due to the jitter. Probably I'm using the wrong sign. Let me just, yeah. For a this is the, yeah, in the worst possible case, this is the situation. Yeah. Okay. If clock 1 and clock 2 have different jitter, which is not really common, it really depends on the cause of the jitter. There are a few causes which can give a different jitter to two circuits that are very close, to two points they are very close to one another. If you look at this situation, there's also a problem that can occur when you consider the whole time. Because if you remember, when the second clock arrives here, what's the situation? We are updating the data on the first clock, and we are updating the data on the second clock. If the first clock is anticipated, okay? If clock 1 is anticipated, so negative jitter, TJ1 smaller than 0, and clock 2 is retarded, if clock 2 is retarded, then TJ2 larger than 0, then we have a problem with the t-hold, because in this case we have that the register R1 starts to update earlier, and the clock for R2 arrives later. So in this case we would need that t-hold plus the skew plus TJ2 minus TJ1. But TJ1 is negative, so this minus TJ1 is still positive, must be smaller than the two contamination delays. So you can see that in this case, if we have the wrong sign of the two jitters, then the constraint on t-hold can be even more problematic. And the other thing that I want to tell you is that this is not a performance problem, because you cannot solve the problem just by reducing the clock frequency. You have no clock frequency in this equation. You have to typically redesign the logic gates or redesign the clock distribution. Okay, just to use the final minutes, I want to now discuss a bit what are the sources of both the skew and the jitter. Because let us first make a simple picture of what is happening here. We have a clock oscillator. This generates the clock. Then from the clock oscillator we have some devices that typically are buffers to distribute the clock. We have buffers also here in another direction, because from the clock oscillator the clock needs to be distributed everywhere, and you need to, let's say, increase the current drive with the buffers. Then you have interconnects that you can indicate with RC networks. These are interconnects Then, for example, for some of this interconnect, you can have coupling with other interconnects. And then you go to a register. To do the sampling. And in all this points, you can have some sources of skew or jitter or both. Let us look in detail. Let's make a list. So, first of all, you have the clock. The clock is a source, of course, it can only be a source of jitter. Because typically the clock oscillator is a VCO, a voltage-controlled oscillator, or in some other cases is a quartz oscillator, and they are typically susceptible to noise and to variations of the supply voltage. So, first source, clock oscillator. Clock oscillator is a VCO, voltage controlled oscillator, or quartz oscillator. And it's sensitive to device noise, so the intrinsic noise of electron devices. The noise of electron device induces some jitter, so variation in the phase of the oscillation. The frequency of the oscillation is pretty fixed by the quartz or by the VCO, but there's no easy way to fix the phase. So the phase can change if there is noise. Then in addition to that, there is the sensitivity to the supply voltage. VDD variations. This is a huge issue because the supply voltage is not constant in time, and there is an easy reason for that. If you consider a simple equivalent circuit of the battery, for example, you need to consider a realistic circuit, and you have a battery and a series of resistance, a resistance in series of the battery. Then you have your circuit here. What happens is that in a normal digital circuit, the current absorbed from the supply from the power supply varies in time. For example, it varies because there's a part of the logic's part of the integrated circuit that at some point switches on and operates, and then switches off. And in modern ICs, when there's a large block that is off, typically, also the power goes off, the clock goes off in that part. So there's an abrupt reduction in the current drawn from the power supply, or an abrupt increase of the current drawn by the current supply from the power supply. And therefore, here the power supply is V0 minus R, the internal resistance, times I, and this quantity can change, and therefore the power supply can change. This is also pretty significant, especially if in modern chips, when you have many parts that are activated and deactivated frequently. And this variation induces variation in the clock phase, in the oscillation phase. Then there is an additional point, an additional issue, which is substrate noise. Because there are some couplings between the oscillator and the rest of the circuit, and then couplings in terms of, for example, capacitive couplings, because there are metals, and therefore there are capacitive couplings between the oscillator and the rest of the chip. And when the rest of the chip operates and voltages vary and so on, also this part is seen by the clock oscillator as a noise, which of course can induce some variations of the phase. So everything translates into jitter. So the clock oscillator is a source of jitter. Then there are device variations. Variations of the MOSFETs. And these are really not predictable. Typically you have, during fabrication, that the threshold voltage is different from the nominal one. And the main reason for that is that, you remember probably I described the ion implantation, the implantation of dopants in the device. The implantation of dopants is not a precise process, in the sense that the exact number of dopants that are injected in a single transistor can change, and therefore, because it's like rain, so it's really not, you cannot really predict how many atoms of dopants are in each transistor, because they are in the order of 30, 40, so it's really a small number. Then you can have variations, and the variations in the number of dopants translate in a variations in the threshold voltage of the device, and of course translate in a variation, for example, of the delay, of a propagation delay of a buffer, and therefore you have some skew. Because you have a higher delay, for example, looking at my illustration, you can have a higher delay because the buffers are slower on the first path with respect to the second path. And therefore, in the two points, you have the same clock, but at different phase, and this difference is constant because it's due to a variation of the threshold voltage, a different threshold voltage of the device. So this is something that translates in a skew. These are, let me write also here, random device variations. Of course, they are not device variations that can be predicted in advance. Okay? This is a skew. Then you have interconnect variations. As I said before, one can typically, let's say, describe the interconnections as RC networks, a network of a resistance and a capacitor. What can typically change is that it's not easy to have a perfectly constant separation between the metal lines, and therefore the dielectric between one metal lines and the other metal lines is not exactly constant, and it is not the thickness, it is not exactly reproducible. If the thickness between two metal lines changes, also, for example, the capacitive coupling changes. And therefore, you have a different delay of one interconnect line with respect to the other. There are several technological tricks in order to reduce this issue, but it's a real issue, which translates, as you can imagine, in a skew. Because it's something that depends on the fabrication process and, of course, is then constant. All these aspects can induce jitter or skew. Some can induce both. For example, some environmental conditions. Two of them are actually really, really important. One is the temperature variation. Temperature variation is terrible because temperature can change the operation of the clock, and can change the delay time of the buffer, or the buffers, for example. So in temperatures, temperature acts in two different ways, because when you have an IC, or let me write here, there you can have both skew and jitter due to temperature. When you have an IC, let for example this one, and you have here a hotspot, a part of the logic here that is really goes faster and it's very dense and therefore dissipates more power than the rest of the chip. Then, of course, you have here a hot region, high temperature here, and the low temperature here. In the region when you have a higher the higher temperature, typically you have a different delay time of the buffer. Depending on the situation, it can be higher or lower. Temperature can act in both ways depending on the type of design. I don't want to go into the detail on this issue, but in this situation you have a skew, because the parts of the chip which are closer to the hotspot have a different phase with respect to the clock phase with respect to the part that are far away, because the temperature is different. Then there is also another point, that is that when there are some regions that are abruptly activated, the temperature in that region can increase in a very fast way in some few milliseconds. It really can increase significantly, easily from 70 degrees to 120 degrees. So an increase of 50 degrees in just 1 millisecond is possible, and this means that you have a variation of the phase of the clock which is very abrupt, and this would be a jitter. Okay, so temperature variations in space can induce a phase difference in space, so a skew, while temperature variation, local temperature variation in time can induce a jitter. Then, for the same reason, you can have VDD variation. I already mentioned that, and again, if the difference is VDD is only spatial, you have also VDD has an impact on the delay time of the buffer. We have already seen it also analytically, and therefore, if you have a variation of VDD because an increased absorption of current from one part of the circuit, you can have a jitter. If you have a different VDD in different parts of the circuit because the distribution is not really perfectly uniform, then you can have a skew. Okay, and with this, we can stop. Thank you.